Liberty Nation with Tim Donner.
It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. Charles Dickens wrote that most famous line in his iconic book, A Tale of Two Cities. Now, I was at a meeting recently when a most compelling question was asked. You've probably heard it before. If you were given your choice of any age to live in, any time period in history, when would you choose to live? So let's say we stop for a moment amid the political chaos and insanity surrounding us and ask a question that's at once both simple and complicated. When would you choose to live? It's certainly thought-provoking. Are we living in the best of times or the worst of times or somewhere in between? Now, some of the people in the room who were asked that question of what period of history they choose to live in, many said the 18th century when the founders did their thing and the American Revolution reshaped the world. A lot of them said the late 19th or early 20th century when America came to lead the world, or the 1950s when America had saved the world from Hitler and established superpower status, or the early 60s with the rise of JFK, or the 80s with the rise of Reagan. But I wonder how many people actually catch the full meaning and context of the age they're living in while they're actually living through it. That's a hard thing to do. But in the here and now, we're in the midst of an internet revolution which has forever changed the world, but also produced a time fraught with peril, as the forces of collectivism thought to be vanquished at the tail end of the 20th and bloodiest century of all rise again. But think about what this internet has meant to your life and mine. You can sit in your room, not even move, and talk with people anywhere in the world for free and have it sound like they're right next door. You can buy any product in the world and have it delivered to your doorstep, sometimes even now the same day. You can access on demand more information than there is in all the libraries of the world and get a Kindle to access virtually every book ever written. You can get Netflix or Prime Video or Hulu and watch every movie ever produced, every TV show. This means people who are sick or disabled or housebound or just lazy can keep their minds sharp and engaged to a degree never thought possible just 20, 30 years ago. So much of life, maybe three quarters of it, is doing things you need to do, work, make money, commute, clean the kitchen, clean the house, sleep, so you can spend the remainder of your time, maybe a quarter of it, doing the things you want to do. And technology makes the things you have to do far more bearable. No more even having to get out of bed to set the alarm in your home or turn down the temperature or monitor where your kids are or your dog is. The things you can do from playing music in one room or several rooms to getting the lights to turn on when you're away so you can feel more safe to printing a document right from your smartphone to recording your weight and body mass index to checking on the efficiency of your REM sleep or checking on whether your kid broke the speed limit when he was driving last time. All of these things you can do simply by looking at a screen and pressing on it two or three times. It means you can get a full range of medical information, check on drug interactions, make hotel and plane reservations, check out product reviews from people who bought what you're interested in buying. The list of things you can do with 21st century technology is, if you just stop for a moment and consider it, remarkable. You can educate yourself quickly and thoroughly on almost any subject because the world's entire storehouse of information is right there at your fingertips. You can raise money for your favorite project or cause with a GoFundMe campaign. Hell, I can tinker with the plan, listen to, even edit the sound bites for this radio show and be productive while I'm getting my hair cut. The technological world we live in is something we not long ago thought a mere fantasy. The stuff we saw on the Jetsons growing up, for those of us of the age. Space age stuff that was never really going to happen. But the cultural and political consequences of the internet are also deeply problematic. The old saying that a lie travels halfway around the world before the truth puts its shoes on has reached its fulfillment in a completely interconnected world. Call someone a racist on social media and that person's tagged forever. Say something indiscreet and you can instantly face the wrath of millions of people who would never respond to you publicly but willingly use the internet's veil of anonymity to torch people indiscriminately. How many young people face depression when they look at Facebook or Instagram and see the wonderful lives of everyone else who's making it seem like their lives are perfect, when in fact they're often a wreck? Posturing has taken on an entirely new meaning with the advent of social media. Groupthink is now more possible than ever. Send out a tweet with a hashtag and you too can become a star or a villain. Doesn't much matter whether what you're putting out there is true or not. And 140-word limits mean we've become more superficial than ever. Revolutions can be launched by social media, as in the Arab Spring, remember that? Which turned into the Arab Winter of discontent. And social media undoubtedly rewards the worst instincts of the cowardly and the depraved and the hate mongers. The internet has changed the world, made it possible to do things we never thought possible, and also for everyone and everything to be outed around the globe in the twinkling of an eye. There's a tendency for each succeeding age to cling to the golden era of their childhood, whatever era that might be, and to repeat the things our parents said that we swore we would never say, sentences starting with things like, back in my day, or these kids today are so spoiled and jaded. You know, humans are prone to do what Simon and Garfunkel so eloquently sang about in their song, The Boxer. People hear what they want to hear and disregard the rest. So, are these the best of times or the worst of times? A case could be made for either. But as for me, for what it's worth, despite the growing horrors of social media and memes and hashtags and an internet dripping with fake news, and despite my own personal fantasy of growing up in the 1920s or 1940s, I'll take now. I'll take living today over any other time I can think of. How about you?